A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed in the view of the foolish to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are at peace. For if before men indeed they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them, and as sacrificial offerings, he took them to himself. In the time of their visitation, they shall shine, and shall dart about as sparks through stubble. They shall judge nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord shall be their king forever. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love. Because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you received a spirit of adoption, through which we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if only we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are as nothing compared with the glory to be revealed for us. For creation awaits with eager expectation the revelation of the children of God. For creation was made subject to futility, not of its own accord, but because of the one who subjected it, in hope that creation itself would be set free from slavery to corruption and share in the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that all creation is groaning in labor pains, even until now. And not only that, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we also groan within ourselves as we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. The word of the Lord.
On behalf of Cardinal George and the Archdiocese, I want to welcome Cardinal Egan, the many bishops and priests, the deacons and religious, our interfaith and ecumenical leaders who have come to pray for the soul of a good and just man who is indeed in the hands of God. And on behalf of all of us, I would certainly like to offer my condolences to Bishop Tim Lyne's sister, Mary, who cannot be with us, his brother Frank and sister-in-law Fran, his many nephews and nieces, their children, and the extended family. And condolences, too, to the priest and the sisters and the people of Holy Name Cathedral, where Bishop Lyne has served so long and so faithfully, to the friends of Bishop Lyne, and indeed, to the whole Archdiocese, where Bishop Lyne has been such a significant presence for so many years. We have lost someone who is very dear to the Church of Chicago, someone who embodied the best of our church, the best of our civic community, and our diverse religious heritage. About 6 months ago, Bishop Lyne and I were driving somewhere, and Bishop Lyne casually asked if I would give the homily at his funeral mass. And so I took a deep breath, and I told him that I'd be very honored, but that it better not be too soon. I don't think that he kept his part of the bargain. Cardinal George summed it up best when he said that he knew Bishop Lyne was 94 years old, but somehow we thought that he would always be there for us. We will truly miss him. Certainly, I know I will miss him very much. We will miss his great sense of humor, his wit, and especially his wisdom. Bishop Tim Lyne was a true gentleman, a great priest, and a faithful and faith-filled bishop. As a gentleman, Tim Lyne was more than just polite and proper. He was one of the most thoughtful people I have ever met. These past few days, so many people have come up and shared stories about the notes that he sent and the phone calls that he made to congratulate them or support them at a difficult time, to encourage them to remember an anniversary or express his sympathy at a loss. There were so many ways that he quietly helped people in their needs and shielded them from some embarrassment. He had a great respect for people, for important people and famous people, but just as assuredly for little people and for those on the margins. And here at the cathedral, for the past 47 years, I think that he has seen them all. And I believe that his respect for people stemmed from a knowledge that indeed we are made in the image and likeness of God, but also it stemmed from a great and gracious heart and a generous spirit that put others before self. He knew what Jesus meant when he said that the grain of wheat must fall to the earth and die, and only then will it produce much fruit. Only in thinking of others and sacrificing for others, only in dying to ourselves and in giving of ourselves graciously and thoughtfully, will we learn the deeper meaning of life. Tim Lyne was someone who embodied that selflessness, that thoughtfulness, the respect and kindness and generosity of spirit of a real gentleman. But along with being a gentleman, Tim Lyne was also a great priest. People at St. Mary's in Riverside and St. Edmund's in Oak Park still remember Father Lyne fondly, a half a century after he left those parishes. And I know that some of them are here today. And for the past 47 years, the people of Holy Name Cathedral have had the blessings of his ministry. And a long time ago here at Holy Name, I remember learning lessons of standing in front of church, of being present to people, about reverently celebrating good liturgy and having good liturgical music, about being with people in good times and in bad, of shaping a vision of parish and teaching people who Christ is. I remember more recent times when he spoke about his own experience of 70 years of priesthood and his undiminished love for priests. It was more eloquent than any vocation talk I've ever heard. It wasn't just that Tim Lyne said, it was also all that he did. It was how he lived his priesthood to the very marrow of his bones. He truly loved being a priest, and he knew how to serve God's people, how to serve the Lord. But Tim Lyne was not just a gentleman and a priest. He was also a faithful and faith-filled bishop. He was named a bishop rather late in life. I think he was 64. And I imagine that it was expected he would serve for 10 or 11 years and quietly fade into the sunset. And he served capably as an Episcopal vicar on the north side of the city in many of the northern Cook County suburbs for 12 years. He was a great pastor to the priest and a caring bishop to the people and the parishes. He celebrated confirmation and the other sacraments, and he preached the faith. And he taught priests and people about a wider sense of church. He taught them about a church that goes beyond the narrow boundaries of our parochial vision. He was also someone who took a great interest in civic affairs and interfaith relations. He played an important part in his role as the face of the Catholic Church in so many different situations with so many different groups. And as a church, we can be very proud of how he represented us. But even after his supposed retirement, he continued as vicar for senior priests. Now, retirement for priests is a relatively new concept. In Chicago, it began in the late 1960s. And as priests, we're not always good at retirement. Sometimes we don't know how to retire or how to retire gracefully. And sometimes we do not take good care of ourselves or know when it's time to give up the keys to our cars or to go into a nursing home. And there really had not been a well-organized system of taking care of retired priests. So Bishop Lyne stepped in and showed us how to take care of our senior priest. He worried about older priests when they were sick. He called on them and visited them when they were living alone or in the hospital or at a nursing home. And he talked to them when hard decisions had to be made. And I remember him telling the story of one older priest whose driving skills had diminished. There had been one or two minor fender benders, and Tim told him that it was time and that he had to give up his keys to the car. The priest wasn't happy, but he told Tim that he always wanted to obey the bishop. So here were the keys to his car. A few days later, the older priest was spotted once again driving his car right down Main Street in the town where he lived. So Tim confronted him once more, and the older priest sheepishly said, "I didn't know the bishop wanted all the keys." Tim just laughed. The older priest wasn't happy, but he gave up his keys because I think he respected Bishop Tim Lyne, respected him as a gentleman, as a priest, as his vicar and bishop. Bishop Lyne taught us so much about being a bishop in the 30 years he served in the episcopacy. As a bishop, he taught us all about being church and loving the church and shepherding the priest and the people. And I think that he could do that because of his own faith and his own experience. To the very core of his being, Bishop Lyne believed, and he believed in the church. He knew the humanity, the faults and flaws of priests and people. He knew it firsthand in his own years as a priest and bishop. And it was not always easy for him. And sometimes it was downright challenging. He was dismayed by the mistakes and horrified by the sins of the church. But he was also a man of great faith. And beyond our flawed humanity and our all too human failings, Bishop Lyne saw the strength of Christ in our weakness and the grace of God that redeems us from the slavery of our sins. And for him, that was the heart of being church. It was in trusting in the Lord. It is and was in learning to be generous and dying to ourselves and learning to live as followers of Christ. God planted the seeds of human potential and a religious vocation into the life of Bishop Timothy Lyne. And Tim responded. In the 94 years of his life, he has produced much fruit. And for that, we come together and we give thanks to God today. We thank God for all that he has done through the life and the ministry of Bishop Tim Lyne. He was indeed a real gentleman, a great priest, and a faithful and faith-filled bishop. We pray that God will welcome Tim warmly into the kingdom of heaven. And let us pray also that all of us will be worthy to join one day with Bishop Tim Lyne and with all of those who are close to us and dear to us in the joy and the peace of God's kingdom.
Thank you. Good morning. I am Susie, one of Bishop Lyne's many nieces. I'm here today on behalf of our family to tell you about the man we loved and called Uncle Timmy. Uncle Timmy has 18 nieces and nephews, 45 grandnieces and nephews, 4 great-grandnieces and nephews. Amazingly, he knew each one by name. Uncle Timmy was always interested in everything everyone was doing. Uncle Timmy would have conversations with us about what was going on in our lives, which really showed us how much he cared. Uncle Timmy was always willing to listen and offer guidance to us as well as our friends with compassion, understanding, and love. Uncle Timmy baptized and married most of us, which made those sacraments even more special. We all are truly blessed and honored to have had him as our own personal shepherd. Family was so important to Uncle Timmy. He loved having Sunday dinner as a family, but often he'd look around and had a look of, "It's a nice place to visit, but I wouldn't want to live here." He and Father Roberts, also known to us as Uncle Wally, often brought us eggnog ice cream from Peterson's for dessert. Everybody knows Uncle Timmy loved his ice cream. He also gave us the love of Notre Dame football. Notre Dame football has become a tradition for more of us to share with our family and friends. Midnight Mass was another love he passed on to us. He always looked forward to spending Christmas here at the cathedral. Many of us still go to Midnight Mass with our families. Uncle Timmy will live on in all of us. We are proud to call him our uncle. We will miss his wisdom, kindness, friendship, and love. We know because of the faith he has shown us that we will see him again someday. I also have a letter here from Ireland that his cousin, Mary Landers, who always came for all his special occasions, her mother, Aunt Nora, which was Uncle Timmy's aunt, and all the cousins from Ireland would like us to read. You can shed tears that Bishop Tim is gone, or you can smile because he has lived. You can close your eyes and pray that he will come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that he has left behind. Your heart can be empty because you cannot see him anymore, or your heart can be full of love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember only that Bishop Tim is gone, or you can cherish his memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back, or you can do what Bishop Tim would want. Smile, open your eyes, love, and go on.
I would like now to call also upon one of Bishop Lyne's dearest friends for many, many decades, His Eminence Cardinal Egan, the Archbishop Emeritus of New York.
First of all, I want to express to the family of our beloved Bishop Lyne my heartfelt sympathy. I know what a terrible loss this is, but I know that you are receiving this cross the way Tim would receive it, with a smile and with deep faith. And so again, to the whole family, and especially to Frank, who I knew in Quigley Preparatory Seminary about 2,000 years ago, I express my heartfelt and deepest sympathy. And to Cardinal George, and all of the people of the Archdiocese of Chicago. I don't know any priest or any bishop who has been more loved than this great, great Bishop Timothy Lyne. He's a man that it's an honor to know. It's a man that brings a smile to your lips no matter what. Man of immense wisdom, and I know, Your Eminence, that you and all of the priests, the deacons, the religious, and the faithful of this great archdiocese have suffered a great loss, and I join you in that. This is one of the heroes of the great Archdiocese of New York. No, of Chicago. Monsignor Mael, I thank you and I thank your people for being such a loving flock for this great bishop. He loved you and he loved the priest here and he loved the people of this wonderful cathedral parish, and he showed that love in a thousand ways. He bragged about the parish and the church altogether too much. But somehow I learned to live with it. I tried to intrude, as I did a minute ago, New York into the whole picture, but I didn't get very far. We went right back to Chicago and stayed where, Ed, it's really at. And I said, Tim, I know it. What a great, great diocese is, and what a great, great parish this is as well. I have been blessed with the friendship of Bishop Timothy Lyne since I was a boy. I knew him back in grammar school, and he was wonderful to our family. During my years in Rome, he took care of both my mother and father in their last days and in their last hours, and the entire Egan family loved this great priest and bishop beyond all measure. I had the great pleasure of living here with him in the cathedral rectory for many years. And I can tell everyone here that doesn't know that he made that rectory a home. You always felt that Bishop Lyne was the head of the house and that you were welcome and he was looking to help you in every way he could. I never felt more at home than I did at 730 North Wabash, Chicago, Illinois, 60611. Tim made it that way. While I was in Rome, we were regular correspondents, back and forth all the time. And Tim was never without a word of encouragement and correction. He was very willing to straighten me out when I said something that he thought was out of line. And he was always right. And I was always better for the correction and better for the encouragement too. During my years back in the United States, on virtually every week, we chatted at least once. And I benefited from the incredible wisdom of this wonderful priest. He, my dear friends, was the best of my counselors. He was the finest example of priesthood and episcopacy that I could imagine. And on top of all of that, he was a dear, dear friend. Last week, in our last telephone conversation, the good bishop talked at some length about our new Holy Father, Pope Francis. Told me how high his hopes were for this great new pontiff and how much he admired him. And I know that in heaven, Pope Francis has a new leader of prayer in Bishop Lyne. I told Bishop Lyne on that occasion when we were chatting that I was going to be next week in Florida to give the priests of the Archdiocese of Miami their annual retreat. And I just waited for the advice to come. There was a pause. There was the Eddie. Eddie, I knew, was when we're serious. Eddie, he said, tell them to take good care of their people. Tell them to take good care of their people. And he added in a turn of phrase that he often used, "Eddie, that's the whole ballgame. Take care of the people. That's the whole ballgame." And what a great ballgame Bishop Timothy Lyne played. A shepherd of souls who gave himself totally to his people in Riverside, in Oak Pike, and of course here at this magnificent cathedral. It was for me a privilege and truly a grace to know this man, to love him and be loved by him. And he will always be in my prayers, he will always be in my heart. We have lost a great priest just for a moment. He's up in heaven taking care of us. And he's telling all of us bishops and priests, take care of your people. That's the whole ballgame.
End of gratitude to Bishop Lyne's family here. I wish to thank in a special way and offer condolences on my part, on the part of the other bishops here, to the priests of the Archdiocese who are here. We have lost an iconic priest in many ways, as we have in recent months lost several others. Priests who, because they have defined the Archdiocese, their ministry also defined our lives. We thank God for them. I want to thank also in a special way the kindness of the ecumenical delegates and the interfaith guests who are here, because this too was testimony to his enormous capacity for friendship. Bishop Lyne was a smart man, but ideas always came with faces attached. And so he maintained these relationships that have to be strengthened as we go forward, because he knew and loved those who represented those different traditions, nonetheless, we hope in many ways complementary. Continue forward to seek the unity that God wants us to enjoy. He was someone who certainly mourned the passing of his contemporaries. That's one of the sorrows of old age. But in another way, he was contemporary, I believe, with everyone. There was no one too old or too young who could not be included in his circle of friends. That just gives testimony, I think, to the greatness of his soul. Soul that was trained from early on, evidently, to recognize others because they recognized him, would often tell stories of people whom he knew and who loved him, that being loved, he could share that gift with others as he did so well. He took great pleasure in his episcopal motto, as you know, from the greeting of St. Paul to the first Timothy, who was a bishop in the apostolic age itself, grace, mercy, peace. These were the words he chose because he knew they were gifts from God to him. They were given freely. Therefore, he could give freely grace and mercy and peace to all those who came in contact with him. We will miss him, but nonetheless, those relationships surmount the grave. They are what bring us into eternity. So we thank God for them. I want to thank also our Holy Father, Pope Francis, who has sent us his greetings through the Apostolic Nuncio and the Papal Secretary of State, Cardinal Bertone. The last time I asked him for advice, and I did fairly often, when I didn't, I regretted it, was before I went to the conclave. We talked a little bit about the state of the church, and I said, well, Tim, do you have any names? And I knew he would. So he had. Won't tell you who they were. This is addressed to me, but it's to all of us. Eminence Cardinal Francis George, Archbishop of Chicago. The Holy Father was saddened to learn of the death of Auxiliary Bishop Emeritus Timothy J. Lyne. He offers heartfelt condolences to you and to the clergy, religious and laity of the Archdiocese. Commending the late bishop to the love and mercy of Christ, your good shepherd, joins in your prayer of thanksgiving for the many graces which accompanied his years of priestly and episcopal ministry to the church in Chicago. To all who mourn Bishop Lyne in the sure hope of the resurrection, His Holiness cordially imparts the apostolic blessing as a pledge of consolation and peace in the Lord, Cardinal Tartuccio, Colonel Secretary of State. Now let us pray. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Timothy. In our farewell, express our affection for him, ease our sadness, and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Father of mercies, we commend our brother Timothy. In the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with Christ on the last day, we give thanks for the many blessings which you bestowed upon Bishop Lyne in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness, of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we meet in Christ, there with you and with our brother forever, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Ave Regina.
Amen.